It is 2.6 billion years ago, and you are walking through the shallow water of a weird beach on the Earth's surface. This is an eon called the Archean, a time span of 1.5 billion years that saw the Earth transform from a world of cooling lava into a planet covered in mighty oceans filled with single-celled life. You look around. What is going on with these colours? This looks more like a sci-fi planet than our Earth. For starters, the sky above you is not blue. Instead, it's a hazy, pale, sickly orange, and you can barely see through it. This atmosphere is our worst nightmare of greenhouse gases. It's an unbreathable cocktail of carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, nitrogen, and methane. This atmosphere would suffocate you instantly because, on top of this mixture, one ingredient is missing: oxygen. But don't worry, you are prepared. You are wearing a special waterproof spacesuit with your own air supply. The result of all this methane and CO2 in the air is an extreme greenhouse climate. Like a giant snuggly blanket over the planet, these molecules absorb the sun's heat, warm the atmosphere, and prevent it from escaping back into space. It's insanely hot on this day in the Archean. The ocean that splashes around your legs is just as weird as the sky. It's green and it feels as hot as a hot springs. And this isn't an organic green, which might have been formed by algae or plants, but instead it's a deep, bright green that looks like it belongs in a test tube of a chemistry lab. You take out a small specimen jar, scoop some up, and close the lid. You hold it up to the sun to let the light shine through. It's a crystal clear emerald color, and it's kind of mesmerizing. It's green because it contains iron oxide, green rust, which is dissolved in the water. Even the sound of the Archean is unsettling. All you can hear are the waves that smash down against the beach, but there are no other sounds. There is no birdsong, no droning insects, no rustle of trees. You take a step, and your foot slips away, and you fall backwards into the shallow water. Instead of a nice, soft seafloor of sand or silt, the substrate under your feet is a hard and slippery slime. It's called a microbial mat, made of billions of years of bacterial buildup. The shoreline, just behind you, is made of a shelf of dark grey volcanic rocks like granites and basalts. But the most curious thing of all are strange rocks that pop out of the seafloor like giant mushrooms. Each one is a knobbly, rounded shape that reaches up to your knees, and they are everywhere in the shallows, stretching far along the coastline as far as you can see. They are called stromatolites, and they were built by some of the earliest life on Earth. A stromatolite is built by photosynthetic bacteria like cyanobacteria that form microbial mats. The top layer is made of living cells linked with polymer filaments. Sediments get trapped in this layer or precipitate out as minerals. Over time, generations of cyanobacteria form new layers on top while the sediment below hardens into rock. Stromatolites like these can be extremely long-lasting, and some still survive to the present day. You can go visit them if you hop on a plane and head over to Shark Bay in Australia. You squat down in the water and take a closer look at one of them. You touch it. It's slimy and rough, and along the sides you see tiny gas bubbles forming, releasing one by one as they fill up. All of these puzzle pieces, the rocks that release gas, the rust green water, the slimy rocks under your boots, they are all caused by bacteria. Here, in the Archean, the prokaryotic cell has completely taken over the world. Now hold on a second. You're visiting right at the very end of this eon. The Archean is 1.5 billion years long, and a lot of other stuff has happened since it first began. At the end of the Hadean and the start of the Archean, the Earth was mostly a ball of drying lava, and now by the end of the Archean, we have a chemical oceanic water world landscape overrun by single cells. That's a pretty profound leap, so let's rewind to the start of the Archean and try and fill in some of the gaps. First, let's talk about the different divisions used in geologic time to help us make sense of these huge stretches of time. I keep saying eon, but what is an eon exactly? An eon is the largest division of geologic time. There are four of them, and each one is several hundred million years to over a billion years long. The first of them was the 500 million years of the Hadean, in which the Earth and the Moon formed, and our planet was a glowing ball of liquid magma, which eventually cooled enough for land to form. Next comes the Archean Eon, the time you're currently visiting where life first began. The next eon after that is called the Proterozoic, the longest eon of all. It stretches almost 2 billion years, and this is where our atmosphere filled with oxygen and life evolved from single cells into the very first complex and multicellular organisms. The last of the eons, the Phanerozoic, is our current eon. This is the action-packed one, where animals, plants, and fungi conquered the Earth. Most of the time, we talk about shorter time frames, especially when we discuss the complexity of the Phanerozoic. Eons are divided into eras, which are usually tens to hundreds of millions of years, such as the Paleozoic, Mesozoic, and Cenozoic of our present eon. Then come periods. They are measured in tens of millions of years. Next are epochs, usually several million years, and finally there are ages, which could be as small as thousands of years. The Archean began with a 300 million year event called the Late Heavy Bombardment. This period of intense asteroid and comet strikes is where most of the water of our oceans came from. Comets of dust and ice smashed into the Earth, melted into water, and left thousands of craters. While those early craters have now been lost because of plate tectonics, the Moon still carries these marks from this turbulent time. Sometime around 3 billion years ago, gigantic sections of the Earth's surface began to move around. They are the tectonic plates, and they've been scooting around ever since, about the same speed as your fingernails grow. They are driven by the movement of the hot mantle layer underneath in a process called mantle convection. Tectonic plates move constantly, and when they collide, they change the Earth's landscapes. When two tectonic plates push directly into each other at a convergent boundary, the immense forces cause one or both plates to buckle. When these convergent boundaries are made of continental plates, an orogenic belt is formed and mountain ranges are compressed and built up. One plate slides underneath the other in a process called subduction, and this is how the Himalayas are being built as the Indian plate crushes into the Eurasian plate. If a continental plate and an oceanic plate meet, a subduction zone can form, forcing the oceanic plate downwards and creating an oceanic trench. One example is the deepest oceanic trench in the present day, the Mariana Trench, which is formed as the Pacific Plate subducts under the Mariana Plate. When plates pull apart, we call this a divergent boundary. This movement causes rift valleys on land and mid-ocean ridges under the water in a process known as seafloor spreading. When two tectonic plates slide past each other in opposing directions, these are called transform boundaries, often causing earthquakes as they grind past each other, just like the San Andreas Fault. If we rewind plate tectonics by 3 billion years, none of our modern continents exist as we know them. What we have instead is a mostly ocean world. The beach you are standing on is on Earth's only continents, which we call Kenoland. Like many continents, Kenoland was centered around pieces of land called cratons, which are ancient and stable continental centers that have survived the stresses of plate tectonics over billions of years. Parts of the Kenoland cratons still exist today. It was made of parts of Western Australia, South Africa, Baltica, and Laurentia, and by matching the age and distribution of the rocks, geologists can start to piece together how these ancient continents were composed. There are even older cratons on Earth too. The Pilbara craton in Western Australia and the Kaapvaal craton from South Africa probably formed even older continents called Ur and Valbara, but because the rock record is so limited, experts still debate what they looked like or whether they even existed at all. Sometime around 3.7 billion years ago, the first organic molecules were being formed in the ideal conditions of heat, water, and ocean chemistry. One day, in this early primordial soup, an organic molecule in the ocean surrounded itself with a membrane and made the leap from being a molecule to being a living thing. This was the beginning of life on Earth. there's still a lot we don't know about this mysterious event. One idea, the panspermia hypothesis, argues that this first life didn't develop on Earth at all. Instead, the idea is that simple life forms are spread throughout the universe and arrived here frozen in the ice of a comet. This first living thing was given a name. It's called LUCA, the last universal common ancestor. It is a hypothetical cell that is the ancestor to the three fundamental domains of life. They are the two prokaryote domains, bacteria and archaea, and one eukaryote group called eukarya, which is where every single animal, plant, protist, and fungi is classified. In 1952, a scientific experiment by Stanley Miller and Harold Urey recreated this Archean ocean in the laboratory. A mixture of water, methane, ammonia, and hydrogen was set up in a glass flask. The solution was heated to induce evaporation, and electrodes created a spark to simulate lightning. After just 1 week, a solution collected in a U-shaped trap had turned deep red. When it was tested, it was found to contain 5 amino acids, the building blocks of DNA. The genetic code of LUCA was possibly carried in a strand of DNA, although some argue that RNA was the first genetic code. LUCA had a water-based cytoplasm and was enclosed from the outside world by a lipid bilayer that could allow ion exchange, and it could divide by cell division. Pretty early on, LUCA split into two major groups of single-celled organisms called prokaryotes. They are the archaea and the bacteria, and in many ways, they are very similar. They are both simple, single-celled organisms with a circular chromosome and no nucleus, and no internal organelles. They both come in similar shapes, such as cocci, bacilli, and spirilli, to name a few. Both also can have thread-like structures called flagella for locomotion. Prokaryotes are anaerobes, which means they use minerals in the ocean to generate their energy in the absence of oxygen, and both likely thrived by oxidizing hydrogen sulfide or ammonia in the ocean depths near the warm water of hydrothermal vents. While archaea and bacteria seem pretty similar, they do have key differences. The first is in the basic structure of their cell membranes. Bacteria have a peptidoglycan polymer that forms a cell wall, while archaea do not. Archaea also tend to live mostly at extremophile habitats, such as hydrothermal vents or high salt environments, while bacteria figured out a way to radiate outwards to all kinds of cool habitats, including the shallow oceans, land, and eventually even infecting living things. For 1 billion years, Earth was the world of the prokaryotes. These two domains of life spread throughout the oceans and thrived, and some curious bacteria might have even started living on land during the Archean. Around this same time, arguably the most successful organism of all time enters the scene. It's called cyanobacteria, and they had a new survival technique that let them proliferate in shallow ocean areas. These bacteria were photosynthesizers. Using the molecule chlorophyll, they used solar energy to convert water and carbon dioxide into sugar for their metabolic pathways. Wherever there was sun and water, cyanobacteria grew like crazy. But this was also the start of a slow apocalypse, which would one day poison this gentle, single-celled world. Cyanobacteria were releasing oxygen. Today, it is abundant in the atmosphere and all aerobic life, including us, needs it to breathe. But free oxygen is highly reactive, and it had a huge impact on the Earth. As an ocean full of cyanobacteria pumped out oxygen every day, year after year, over 300 million years, all that oxygen combined with whatever reactive substances it could find. For a long time, oxygen reacted with iron in the ocean to create iron oxide, also known as rust. Iron oxide formed in anoxic conditions is unstable and is green in color, which stained the Earth's oceans green. There was another chemical reaction taking place in these oceans. Oxygen reacted with iron to create silver or black iron oxide, called magnetite or hematite. When oxygen flooded the oceans, these iron oxides settled onto the seafloor as black layers, and then alternated with red iron pore silicon oxide, also known as microcrystalline chert or jasper. These black and red layers might have fluctuated as the oxygen levels changed, and as these minerals settled in the ocean floor over the eon, they created red and black stripy rocks, collectively called banded iron formations. Each layer is just a few millimeters or centimeters thick, but over a billion years, these rocks could be hundreds of meters thick. Today, this is where we source much of our iron. Another idea about the Archean Earth has also been suggested, called the Purple Earth Hypothesis. It suggests that early photosynthesizers used a molecule called retinol, which is even simpler than chlorophyll. Retinol looks purple, and if enough retinol bacteria bloomed in the oceans, the Earth could have had purple water. You look all around you at the beach of stromatolites. There are hundreds of them all around, each one like a continuously inhabited city with 3.5 billion years of history written in the stone. As the Archean Eon draws to a close 2.5 billion years ago, the cyanobacteria were pumping out massive amounts of oxygen, their bubbles fizzing to the surface of the emerald green ocean. As the amount of iron in the oceans was running out, a dangerous tipping point was approaching. The oxygen had to go somewhere, and in the following eon, the Proterozoic, it all went horribly wrong. The tiny bacteria would pay the ultimate price for all the good times that the cyanobacteria experienced. The sky was going to change, the temperature was going to drop, and the mother of all ice ages was going to crash upon this calm bacterial paradise. If you're interested in learning about the worlds of deep time, make sure to like and subscribe.